He knew that that would have not been what God had called him to do. So he said, no, I'm not going to do that. You shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And the snake tried to give him all the kingdoms of the world. That's a leadership lesson. He was trying to give him something before he was ready for it. How many leaders get something before they're ready for it? Destroy it, mess it all up. All right. And then he takes him to the top and he says, go ahead and jump off. They'll catch you. All right. Trying to get him to do something that God never told him to do. You shall not tempt the Lord your God. Those were thoughts that came to Christ. If I bow down, I can have all these kingdoms. I don't have to die. Peter stood up and said, Jesus said, I'm going to have to die. And Peter stood up and said, I'm not even going to let this happen. And Jesus looks at him and says, get behind me, Satan. Because he recognized it for what it was. He said, that's a thought. Jesus didn't want to die. And here's this person trying to feed into that. He said, get behind me, Satan. Get behind me. He had to make sure that his mind was focused. And Eve refused to do that. She began to think about those things. In fact, 2 Corinthians 10:3-5 says this. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. In order to love God with our mind, we have to bring our thoughts into subjection to Christ, into subjection to the Word. Okay? This is why many Christians fail. Because when they start to have thoughts, they refuse to bring it into subjection to the Word of God. Let's talk about an example. There are people who desire to love God, but when the battle begins to take place in their mind, they can't get the victory. Depression comes upon them. They begin to think about all the reasons they should be depressed. They start thinking about all the failures in their life, all their shortcomings, all the bad stuff that happened to them, all their financial problems, all their health issues, all their family problems, all their childhood events, all their teenage events, all their adult events, everything that's happened in their life that gives them the reason that they should be depressed. And God says, you know what? That's not what you should do. When those things start to come upon you, this is what the Word says. He says, you know what? You need to think on these things. Whatsoever is true, honest, just, pure, lovely, of good report, anything that has virtue, anything to be praised, think on these things. Don't allow your mind to continue to focus upon the negative and drag you further and further into depression. And it's not just depression. It's lust, it's pornography, it's drugs, it's alcohol, it's whatever your temptation is. Power. Anytime your mind starts taking you to that place that you know is not God's will for your life, it's not God's will. You need to check your mind and you need to say, not so. And you need to cast down those imaginations. You need to bring that thought into captivity. You need to say, nope, you ain't running away with that thought. In fact, I'm putting you right here. Because the Word of God says, I'm blessed coming in. I'm blessed going out. I'm blessed in the field. I'm blessed in the house. I'm blessed here. I'm blessed there. I'm blessed everywhere I go. I ain't got no reason to be depressed. Yeah, I feel depressed, but we've already said feelings are deceitful. You need to understand that that's a deceitful spirit trying to come upon you, and you need to put it into subjection and say, nope, 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 nope. I'm worshiping God with my mind right now. That means I'm bringing that thought into captivity. That thought that makes me want to get on the internet and look at that stuff I ain't supposed to be looking at. I need to bring that into captivity. Because what happens is if I allow myself to sit there and go, well, okay, I'm going to bring that in. Okay, no, God doesn't want me to do that. And I sit there and I start thinking about it. And I think about it some more. And I think about it some more. Think about it some more. You know what's eventually going to happen? We're going to be logging on, looking at stuff we shouldn't be looking at. You see that person in your office and you start thinking about all the reasons that you'd be happier with that person. All the reasons that your life would be so much better if that was your spouse. You need to bring that into subjection, because that's adultery. That's one of the big ten. Thou shalt not commit adultery. And we start going, and we entertain that thought, and before you know it, we're just friends. It's just a cup of coffee. No big deal. And then conversation leads into more than friendship, leads into more and more and more, until you find yourself in a place where God never intended you to be. In the middle of an affair somewhere, destroying your family, destroying everything that you've worked hard to build, all because your thought got away from you. We have to bring those ungodly thoughts into the obedience to the word. Romans 12:1 tells us that we are transformed by the renewing of our mind. In other words, as my mind is renewed, I'm changed. I become a new person. All right? I become a new person. For example, I haven't always been a Christian. Thought I was a Christian, but hadn't always been. All right? When I was little, I went to church, was involved in church, said the prayer, all that kind of stuff, but never knew what it meant to walk with Christ. You know, anybody else ever been there? Okay. So as a result, junior high school, hung out with people that used words and language that's unbecoming. Okay. And even after I became a Christian, I never really thought about it until one day I read in the Word, Colossians chapter 3, verse 8. But now ye also put off these things, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. And I thought, man, I shouldn't be doing that. And then I had to make a conscious effort to stop saying those words. But what I found is the more I got into the Word and more that I allowed Christ to speak to me through the Word, I found myself becoming the kind of person that I would look at and go, why did I ever talk like that? Who was I trying to impress? Do I got time? I got just a little bit. I got to talk about profanity, all right? Let me tell you about profanity. It's called profanity. It's called vulgarity. The reason for that is because those words mean common, okay? They both mean common. And the reason they call it common is because that was the kind of language that was used by the common people. Back in the day, common people, the slaves, the servants, the serfs, those types of people were not educated. They were not given access to education. And as a result, they had limited vocabulary. So as a result, they resulted to using slang terms and profanity and vulgarity because they were uneducated. Now, today, we all educated. Bethel is a place of smart people, educated people. You may not have gone to college, but you're educated, all right? Don't be common. Don't use vulgarity. Don't use profanity. Ain't nothing smart about it. All these kids running around thinking it's cool. Stupid. And that's exactly what it was used by the stupid people. Because they didn't know no better. Anyway, I'll get off my soapbox on that. All right? But what I found is as I renewed my mind, as my mind became changed, I found myself obeying the word. It said don't talk like that, and I wasn't talking like that. And it was like I was changed, and all of a sudden I found myself just living in obedience to the word. And what I realized is, man, this is what it means to love God with my strength. Because loving God with your strength just simply means doing it. Most of us fail to do it because we got issues in all these other areas. But if you can learn to get those other things in line, then it's a natural progression for you to love God with your strength, because your mind, your heart, and your soul is already in subjection to Him. Now your body must come into subjection. Because loving God with your strength is just doing what He wants you to do. It's fasting, even when you don't feel like it. It's praying, even when you got other things to do. It's making yourself study the Word. It's loving that person that gets on your nerves. It's forgiving that person that hurts you. It's returning that money that you found. It's honoring your father and mother. It's when you don't lie. It's when you don't murder. It's when you don't covet. It's when you don't commit adultery. It's when you're doing what God wants you to do. In other words, it's obeying God's commandments. It's worshiping God. It's worship. It's simply obeying what He's called us to do. That's worship. Adam and Eve failed to love with their strength. God said, don't eat it, but they ate of it anyway. They couldn't obey His commandment. And the reason they couldn't obey His commandment is because they didn't take time to bring their mind into subjection. They couldn't get their mind into subjection because their soul had not been submitted. And their soul wasn't submitted because really in their heart, they desired the tree more than God. And because they did not love Him, their worship was in vain. They weren't able to live in obedience. Perhaps you're here tonight and you find yourself repetitively failing to obey God's commandments. You want to, you have a desire, but for whatever reason, you just find yourself constantly failing to live up to what God wants you to do. Could I be so bold as to say it's because somewhere you don't love God the way you need to? Somewhere you have not brought yourself, your whole mind, soul, body, and strength into submission to His will, to His word, to His commands. And I know people out there going, well, you don't know me. You don't know what's going on. Yes, I do. Because I've been there. The reason God was dealing with me about this is because I was going through that. And I had to ask myself, why? Why am I at a place where I just can't seem to stay on the right path? And God led me to that scripture, and He said, that's why. Because you've not given me your heart, soul, mind, and body. He said, if you can do that, you'll stay on the right path. You'll learn to worship me. You'll learn to walk in obedience. You'll learn to be obedient to what I say. Stand to your feet tonight. I'm going to ask, is Kyle and them in here yet? We're getting out a little bit early, but that's all right. Because again, we don't need music to worship. We just need to obey God. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Because what I want you to ask yourself right now is, where in your life have you failed to worship? Maybe you're here today and you fail to worship with your strength. You know what you should do, but you don't do it. Is it a spirit of rebellion? Or is there something deeper? Is it because you've not really gotten your mind under control? Thoughts come and you entertain them and you begin to fantasize. And you begin to focus on all the negative. You need to bring your mind into obedience. You need to get into the Word and you need to allow it to change you. See what's expected of you. Be renewed. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Be washed by the water of the Word. Get your mind under control. Maybe it's your soul today. Maybe you're living outside the will of God. You know that God's called you to something, but you've decided your will is more important. He's called you to the mission field, but you don't want to go. He's called you to preach, but you're running. Your will is not submitted to Him. He's never called you to be with that person, but your will wants them more than His will. He would say, I got something better for you if you'll obey my will. You may have to wait, but the promise will come. Bring your soul into subjection to Him. Or maybe you're here tonight and it's your heart. You've never brought your heart into subjection. You've never allowed your heart to surrender to God. God loves you. He cares for you. He died for you. And He died for you so that your heart can be cleansed. So that your